A new CNN national poll releasing right now, this moment, shows that former Vice President Joe Biden has regained a double-digit lead over the rest of the crowded Democratic field. It's the first CNN poll since the CNN debates in Detroit. And the big takeaway are that Biden's numbers are nearly double those of his nearest rivals, Senator Bernie Sanders and Elizabeth Warren. The poll also reinforces Biden's key strength, which is electability. Biden's campaign is embracing this and stressing the need to beat President Trump in his first TV ad, which will air in Iowa this morning.
Yeah, that released just moments ago as well. So no other candidate has made any meaningful gains in the new CNN poll. Have we mentioned, by the way, this is a brand new CNN poll. No major gains for anyone but Biden, but significant, sizable losses for one candidate. Senator Kamala Harris, she has dropped a whole bunch since June, erasing the boost she got after the first Democratic debate. One other note, this poll secures former Housing Secretary Julian Castro's spot on the debate stage in September. He is now the 10th candidate to qualify. CNN's political director David Chalian joins us now with the big takeaways of this brand new CNN poll. David, take it away.
Yeah, guys, let's take a look at those numbers again. Here's the Democratic horse race, sort of where it stands right now. Joe Biden, commanding lead in this race nationally. Remember, this is a national picture right now. We know the nomination is fought state by state, Iowa, New Hampshire, Nevada, South Carolina, but here he is, double-digit lead, 29%. Sanders and Warren in a battle tied there for second place. Sanders at 15, Warren at 14. Buttigieg and Harris at 5, everyone else 3%. Or below. Look at the movement. We last polled in the immediate aftermath of the first debate, the Miami debate. And take a look. You can see, if you see where they were in June, in our June poll, compared to now, Joe Biden has returned. Remember, he took a hit on that debate stage. He's now back up 7 points. 29% is about where he was prior to that Miami debate. The only other big movement we see here is that Kamala Harris drop, okay? She was at 17% in June. She's now down to 5, back down in single digits where she was before that Miami debate. So what we saw is that that was a huge moment in this race, but it wasn't long lasting. We also asked whether people are looking for a candidate to beat Donald Trump or one that shares their position. Oh, sorry. I want to give you a little sense of the coalition first that Biden has. Take a look at the ideological split between liberals and moderate and conservative Democrats, guys. I find this fascinating. Biden, Sanders, Warren, they are in a battle for the liberal Democrats. Those identify as liberal. But he is running away with the moderate conservative vote, just like he does with older Democrats, just like he does with self-identified Democrats versus independents who say they're going to vote in the Democratic primary. This is key to his coalition, as we know, our African-American voters. Now I want to show you that split about, are you looking for someone to beat Donald Trump, or are you looking for someone who shares your position on the issues? 54% of Democrats in this poll say they want a candidate with a strong chance of beating Trump. 39% say they're looking for a candidate who shares their position on the issues. This is actually a little lower than we've seen before, this notion of just finding the one that can beat Trump. Look at some demographics on this issue, how it divides. Take a look when you compare white college-educated voters to non-college-educated voters. It is amazing. If you are a white non-college educated voter in this poll, you're actually more in favor of someone who shares your positions than beating Trump, but just it splits evenly here. Take a look at the college educated white voters in this poll. 65% looking for a Trump defeater, 29% somebody who shares their issue on the position on the issues. We see the same thing on age. This is also really interesting. If you are 45 or older in this poll, my God, it's like more than 2-to-1. You want somebody who can defeat Donald Trump, 66% to 25%. That advantage flips the other way for younger voters. 56% of younger voters want someone who shares their positions. 41% say they want somebody who can beat Trump. What you see here, of course, is this is Biden territory, the 45 plus. This is more Warren territory, Sanders territory, the young voters. So you can see the difference of the electability argument you're saying that is clearly present in Joe Biden's new ad in Iowa, guys.
Very interesting, David. Stay with us if you would. We have more questions, but we want to bring in Alex Burns, our CNN political analyst and national political correspondent for The New York Times, and Kirsten Powers, CNN political analyst and USA Today columnist. Great to have you guys help us analyze what we're seeing in these numbers. So, Alex, Joe Biden is waking up in a very good mood this morning. I mean, he's run for president, obviously, before. I don't think he's ever broken double digits. And the idea that nothing that's happened in the debates, the hit that he took from Kamala Harris, none of his sort of verbal missteps, he's only been climbing in the polls.
The good news for Biden here is both that he still has this significant lead, that he hasn't lost much ground since that first debate. He's recovered ground since the aftermath of that first debate. And on top of that, that there still is not a coalescing of liberal opposition to his campaign. The warning sign for Biden in this poll, right, is that he's still polling at roughly 30%, a tick below 30%. That's not an overpowering lead in this race. And if you're at 29% when there's this field of a million candidates, the question is, can he actually win over people who don't already support him as the field gets narrower? But for the people who are opposed to Joe Biden, you have Elizabeth Warren and Bernie Sanders clearly drawing on an important well of opposition, liberal populists, especially younger voters and more ideological voters. Everybody else in this race, including candidates who we have thought of as pretty formidable competitors, like Kamala Harris, like Pete Buttigieg, like Cory Booker and Julian Castro after those debate performances, they have not figured out what their path is in this race yet. They need somebody else to stumble, or they need to break out in a much bigger and more sustained way than they have so far.
I have to say, and it seems like the Biden team has fully embraced what they see as their path to victory, which is we can beat Trump. They're jumping in with more than both feet. If you can jump in with 4 feet, that's what they're doing this morning. They have the new ad, which we'll show you in a minute. And then Jill Biden, the vice president's wife, said something out loud last night in New Hampshire, which is not the type of thing you normally hear from a campaign. Listen to what Jill Biden said.
I know that not all of you are committed to my husband. And I respect that. Your candidate might be better on, I don't know, health care than Joe is. But you've got to look at who's going to win this election. And maybe you have to swallow a little bit and say, okay, I sort of personally like so-and-so better. But your bottom line has to be that we have to beat Trump.
So, Kirsten, not the candidate you might like, but the candidate you might need? That's an interesting message from a campaign this morning.
Yeah, I mean, I think it would have been more effective to say that he has a great health care plan and he can beat Trump. You know, I don't know that you need to concede that he might not have the best health care plan, but vote for him anyway. I don't know why she chose to go that route. I think it's fair to, you know, remind people how important it is to beat Donald Trump, and that he is the person that a lot of people feel is the person who could beat Trump. So I don't think there's any real problem with that. The one thing I would say is that, you know, the liberal vote, the sort of Bernie Sanders and Elizabeth Warren vote, which is definitely, you know, a decent group of people, they're splitting that, you know? So I think it makes it seem a little more like, it makes Biden seem a little farther ahead than I think he is. Because if you were to combine those and, you know, and it was just one person, then you would have, you know, roughly the same amount, roughly the same percentage that Joe Biden's getting. So right now he's benefiting from the fact that there are so many other people in the race, you know, who are dividing the vote. I don't know that he, you know, that this is sustainable as people start dropping out and it starts becoming a more a clear decision between different people. And then people may come around also to believing that perhaps Elizabeth Warren is the best person to beat Donald Trump.
Yeah, I mean, we've got more than a year to go. So anything.
Well, but you don't until Iowa. We don't have more than a year to go. Iowa's February.
Good point.
And Donald Trump, by the way, in August of 2016, was well ahead in August and never slipped behind except for like a second to Herman Cain. I mean, you can solidify a lead.
August of 2016.
Right.
But and we're in August of 2015, right?
Sorry,
now.
It was August of 2015 he went ahead. And then he stayed ahead the whole time. We just don't know. It might be that Biden has solidified and might never drop. And it isn't that far. It's not a year. It's 6 months. Not even.
So the motto, my husband, he's good enough, might be working for Jill, and Joe. That could work. But David, I'm curious, what is the thinking behind what's happening with Kamala Harris? Because she's been out stumping. We've seen her in Iowa doing all of the right things. So what's the thinking about that drop?
Yeah, so I don't think there's a massive amount of concern about the drop. I think there was an understanding. Our poll is showing what other polls had shown since that Miami debate, which is that while she scored a moment, it wasn't long lasting. So that was an artificial high that she had. I think they're back to sort of figuring out how to break into that group of the top three and consistently stay there. And as you said, she's been out and about and campaigning more. She's leaning more into Iowa, as John notes, its importance of where it is up front in the calendar. But I don't sense any sort of panic. This is a return where we were before that first debate.